Good afternoon, open source fans, and welcome back to London, England. We're here blazing through day one of our live coverage at KubeCon, CloudNativeCon. My name's Savannah Peterson in the cockpit with the one and only Rob Strecce, as always, for these events. Rob, today is really going by. I'm not even kidding when I say blazing by.
This has been blazing by, and I think it's been just the community, the content, and understanding how it's helping companies really move their infrastructure forward has been a lot of fun.
It has been a lot of fun. We're going to continue the fun with our next guest. We have Alex Dobre and Kanika Gera. Thank you so much for taking
Thank
the
you.
Time. Exciting week for y'all. I know that Adobe was on stage at OpenShift Commons mm-hmm. yesterday. You're on day two. Here we are, day one of our coverage. You're on day two. Can you tell us a little bit about what you presented on at that event? Kanika, I'll start with you.
Sure. So we presented on a custom solution where we brought our own CNI to OpenShift. Which is very exciting.
That's super exciting. Congratulations.
Yes, thank you. So we went with, I think a year back, our research into OVM, which is the default CNI that comes in with OpenShift, and it was not meeting our specific use case requirements. And we went in with adopting our own CNI, which I think was amazing, great learning curve, as well as for the team, I think it was really exciting for our engineering team to look into and bring in Cilium mm-hmm. to plug in as our CNI.
That's awesome. How long have you been working on this? I can imagine it feels like quite a celebration to be able to share that.
I think almost 3 years.
Yeah, I was part of the, I was leading the adoption of OpenShift at Adobe from the technical standpoint. Mm-hmm. It took us a couple of months, 7 to 8 months maybe.
That's still pretty fast.
It was, yeah. We got some, you know, good help from the from Red Hat, from OpenShift. Good collaboration. We had great consultants to work with. Yeah, so it was about this bring your own CNI thing. As Kanika mentioned, the default networking setup that comes with OpenShift, OVN, and Maltus is great from most of the use cases in the industry. For us, we needed something consistent with all the other providers that we have, right? And that was Cilium. So how to achieve that? We worked together with OpenShift. They helped us with a method to provision a Kubernetes cluster, an OpenShift cluster, without any of the CNI configured at all. And that's where we take the networking configuration into our own hands with the bring your own CNI. We brought our own CNI to picture, right?
So what drove you down that path? What was different that you saw that maybe others are out there that can learn from this, that hey, this is why we went down this path?
Yeah, so like I said, there was the consistent driver of the entire project. We needed a way to provision Kubernetes clusters across multiple providers that are as close as possible one to each other. And since we were already using Cilium on the other providers, we wanted to go with the same one as the same CNI for OpenShift as well. And like from a technical standpoint, yeah, Cilium comes with eBPF, yes. That allows for programmable networking directly into the Linux kernel. There's no need for writing your own kernel module to accomplish that. That means that there is no need for any sort of hot reload, hot restart. All the security policies can be created, applied, and updated on the fly, and that's great from a scalability standpoint, right?
I think just to add to that, for our use case, what the team we're part of is the Adobe infrastructure team. So we have a platform which is a managed Kubernetes platform called Ethos.
Yep.
And for us, we serve a lot of customers, tenants internally, which is like hosting across all the clouds. We do private cloud, we do Azure, we do AWS, so we are all across. And I think when we were going this route, that was our biggest factor to adopt something that would meet our needs across the cloud.
So the part of it was the interoperability
and
consistency that you know how this is going to work with all of those
yes.
clouds and everything like that.
So,
yep.
I think generally an assumption with networking is people treat networking as plumbing. Hey, this should work. And for us,
true.
It was like, this is something that's getting very, very important enough network flexibility in a Kubernetes cloud native world now. So we're like, okay, let's bring this, pick this challenge up, bring something of our own, see how we can bring our own CNI here.
That's exciting and refreshing to hear. I can imagine that it must feel really good to have released this into the world. Yes, so let's talk a little bit about this community, open source community. What does that mean for Adobe? I'll start with you, Alex. I saw you nodding.
Yeah, no, it is great. So it's my first KubeCon that I ever attended.
Oh my gosh.
Great to be here, yeah. Unfortunately, I don't get to stay much because some family matters. Yeah. Right after this talk, I'm going straight to the airport. But it feels great to be here. It was like yesterday, the OpenShift Commons session. It was very well organized. We got all these very interesting talks. We had some good, fun times prepared by the Red Hatians with the OpenShift superhero awards, they call it. Yeah.
Fun.
Like with capes and everything. So much fun.
Wait, were you both wearing capes yesterday?
No. We weren't getting the awards, but you know, the celebration of that happened.
I think Alex is going to be wearing one soon, right?
I don't know. Nominate me if you want. I'm just kidding.
Next time you're on the show, I expect the capes. That's
okay,
all I'm saying.
Cool.
Yeah.
Perfect.
All right.
So
yeah.
For me, this is my third KubeCon, and the most exciting one is I've attended three KubeCons across continents. One was in US, other one in India, and this is third, London. Looking forward for the next one. So
you're KubeComing all over the globe.
Yes,
that's impressive. Now go ahead and finish your sentence, and then I have a follow-up.
That's what I think product person is supposed to do, right?
Yeah, I suppose.
Travel across,
especially
the globe.
With the reach of Adobe. No kidding. So is there a big difference in those community? What's your experience been like in those different locations? Have your conversations been similar, or?
I think it's been a very interesting flavor, and the reason I say is. There are so many people out there who have such a different perspective, and it also comes in from regions. Yeah. Like when we are working with NA, it's like there's a different set of problem of scale, there's a different problem from cost aspects.
Yeah.
And then when you're working with communities in India, there are so many great ideas people want to incubate. There are so many plugins, there are so many things people want to do interestingly. And here, we still do explore, still in day one, I think, just got to day zero. But it was amazing to see people wear that Red Hat caps. Oh my God, they're amazing.
They are very iconic.
Yes.
They're kind
they
of the scene of the show floor. We'll have to bring the capes into the hats.
Yes.
We've got a whole thing going on.
I think the next interview should be with all the hats.
Yes. Absolutely.
We had one hidden behind some of the Red Hat people here earlier so that to make them feel at home. But but when you look at this, and now that you have your CNI that you've built, are you seeing that people in the Cilium community are reaching out and saying, hey, you know, help us understand so that they can learn and it can be more consistent? Because to me, that seems like something very, not easy, but it makes a lot of sense to
me. It does make a lot of
sense. You know, because I think, and I was at one of the hyperscalers that you mentioned prior life, and one of the things that was always hard was networking. Networking was, and didn't matter if it was inside our data centers, outside or between data centers, between clouds. Have you found, because you do a lot of that, is this one of the steps that eases your ability to do that networking in and out of clouds? Because you're hybrid in some nature.
I can start with that. Okay. So as I said, we work across clouds, and our main goal here was with this standardization. As an organization or a platform team, I would not want my customers or tenants to manage multiple networking ways. We would want to have something that's one. I do not want developers to sit down at 2 a.m. and, you know, troubleshoot and scratch their heads.
Right.
So that's from my perspective. I think from a product perspective is something that's more tangible for and easy to use for all the developers across and a consistent experience from a developer perspective. Alex, your thoughts.
I love what you just said, and then we'll I love to hear what Alex has to say too, but you brought up something really important. You talked about standardization. Standardization equates to simplification for the developer and the users and the community on that side.
And that is part of my job, simplifying all the developers' life.
Super easy job you have, hardly. It's incredibly complex.
Yes.
Alex, you can go ahead and chime in there too.
Yeah, no, so I wanted to say that equally important to this, all the complex part of the security, of the networking is security, right?
Yeah.
And one thing that we learned out of all this effort that we put together was that we were reconfirmed once again that security, that networking and security, there are not trivial things to do. That they are not trivial to accomplish, that are not easy, and you need to put additional effort and you need to pay extra attention to how to implement networking from a secure standpoint. And that is very important for our teams because we wanted their focus to be on writing code rather than making sure their workloads are functional from a networking perspective, as well that they are secure enough not to care about it, right? As about leveraging the community and the open source, yes, we are present on the Cilium Slack channels, Cilium open Slack channels, right?
Yes.
We do see a lot of requests coming in and then, and we try to answer with our own experience if possible. If they're, the questions that are being asked there, they overlap with what we did already, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So I think as Alex mentioned, security, and I suddenly was like, oh my God, have I signed up for everything difficult at Adobe?
Yeah, I'm beginning to think so, Kanika.
Yes, I also manage security product management-wise for our developer platform teams, and while he was talking to us, like, oh my fucking Lord. Okay, so we have adopted a lot of CNCF projects, and this conference actually is amazing for network. Mm. You cannot imagine the value and the strength of collaboration and networking it brings out. I think we've been in situations where we have solved and ideated things just in a hallway conversations. I think that's where most great innovations happen, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or ideas spark.
Yeah, absolutely. It kind of gives me chills as you say that, because that is the magic of being together and getting to have these conversations. And you're talking about solving, you said that so casually, oh, we're just chatting in the hallway. You're talking about incredibly complex problems that you're able to solve because of the collaborative nature. I think that's really one of the, and we, I know we all probably agree on this, but that's one of the powers of the open source community is we're here to build better together. And it's less of a, I mean, there's obviously competitors behind us, but it's not about that. It's about doing the right thing, making the developer user experience amazing no matter where you're working or what cloud you're using, to your exact point. No, I'm really glad you brought that up. Okay, so big announcements this week. Very curious to hear what's next. So I'm going to phrase this question in a way that we can lure you back onto the show when we're in Amsterdam next year for your now probably fifth KubeCon in that case, and your second or maybe third, who knows. What do you hope to be able to say a year from now that you can't yet say today? What's next?
You want to go first?
This is a tough question. Good one. So what I would like to see is at least the same level of excitement that the open source community brings, if not more. I know that it's already at the high level, like skyrocket, but you know, I want more. You know, I'm an open sourcer, I want more. yes, Kanika?
I'm going to start wearing my product hat now. Okay, so I want everybody to stay curious.
Yes.
And I'm so glad we're out of pandemic, so we can all sit together and chat like this. I hope people, everybody across, engineers, products, leadership, everybody stays curious, keeps building humbly, and understands the customer pain. That's most important. I want everybody across here attending this conference to be the driver of the change. And not just, you know, sit down and be a facilitator or enabler, but the driver. So that's my message out there. Have fun, talk to each other. I have a green badge, so talk to me for all the great ideas and stay curious.
Well, that was just a perfect inspirational note to end on. I love hearing this. Coming from a company as well-known and reputable as Adobe, come say hi. Come ask us questions. Come tell us what you need. It truly is open. Y'all are practicing what this community preaches, and mm-hmm. we really thank you both for taking the time. This has been such a fantastic segment.
And you're amazing, both of you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having us here.
Yes, absolutely. Anytime. You are welcome on our stage anytime. I know I speak for Rob and I.
Absolutely.
Rob, thank you for a lovely conversation. And thank all of you for tuning in to our wonderful 3 days of coverage here in London, England at KubeCon, CloudNativeCon. My name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.